So the first thing I would like is a disclaimer. I'm not claiming that cryptography is the answer to every problem on earth. Whoever thinks this problem can be solved using cryptography doesn't understand his problem and doesn't understand cryptography. So be very careful. Any security problem, you say, let's deploy cryptography. That makes no sense. Understand clearly what is the problem before you say that it should have a cryptographic solution. There are many non-cryptographic solutions to security, so be careful. Okay, so cryptography is dealt with in many chapters of this book, in particular 4, 5, 6, 8, and 9, and also in chapter 7, which deals with the cryptographic hash. So let's look at some of these things because they are really important. They are the sort of building blocks of many security systems, but not all of them. Cryptography is a science of disguising messages so that only the intended recipient can decipher the received message. The sender transforms the message of plain text into ciphertext, a process referred to as encryption, and the reverse process of converting the ciphertext back to the plain text is referred to as decryption. So you can think of encryption as being a function, the encryption function. This P is the plain text. So you apply the encryption function on the plain text with a key little e, and you get the ciphertext. And at the receiver side, you take the ciphertext and you apply the decryption function with little d, the decryption key, and you get back the plain text. So these are the this is the notation. So this is the plain text, this is the ciphertext, this is the encryption function, and the little e is the encryption key. Again, this d is the decryption function and the little d is the decryption key. Now there are two types of cryptography, as you probably already know. One is symmetric key cryptography, so called symmetric because e is the same thing as d, the same value. So both the sender and the receiver must know this value to encrypt and decrypt. Also called secret key cryptography, and there are many well-known algorithms for this, including data encryption standard DES, AES, advanced encryption standard, RC4, IDEA, Blowfish, and so on and so forth. So many things that are in use even today. A user who wishes to communicate with n other persons would have to maintain a total of n separate secret keys, one per user he wishes to communicate with. So this is the feature of secret key cryptography. So if I'm over here and there are n other people, then for each person, for communicating with each of those individuals, I need to have a separate secret key so that only he and I share that key and nobody else can encrypt or decrypt messages that go between us. So now this is a hassle because I have to maintain n such keys. Can we think of a better scheme? And the answer is yes, and that is public key cryptography. So the encryption key E is public. So whoever wants to encrypt a message to send to me must know my public key E, and then I and only I can decrypt the message because I have the corresponding, I have knowledge of the corresponding private key D, the decryption key, which is mathematically related to this E. So examples of public key cryptography are RSA and ECC. So this is covered in chapter 6 and this is covered in chapter 9. Now obviously there are these two things, secret key cryptography and public key cryptography. A sensible question is, what is the advantage of one over the other? So as I mentioned before, in the case of secret key cryptography or symmetric key cryptography, the problem is that every person has to maintain n secrets, one per entity he wishes to communicate with. So there is this problem of key management. On the other hand, in the case of public key cryptography, all I need is my public key, private key pair. In particular, I only need to maintain this thing very safely and very securely. So this is in the case of public key cryptography. But obviously, something tells us there must be some disadvantage of public key cryptography, and that disadvantage is that it is much slower compared to secret key cryptography. Orders of magnitude, perhaps about 1,000 times slower than secret key cryptography. So the obvious question is, can we combine these two, public key and secret key cryptography, to get the advantages of both? So how do we actually do that? So what's the problem? The problem is A has got a message M and he wants to send that to B so that only B can read it. So what does A do? A takes the message. So before he even takes this message, he generates a random key K, which is just a session key. He just uses this K for the duration of a session. So he chooses this random number K, encrypts the message M using that key K, and this encryption is secret key encryption. Once again, generates a random number K, which is used as the key to encrypt M using secret key cryptography. And this thing is then sent together with this. So the key K is encrypted with B's public key. So I'm assuming that A wants to send a message to B and that A knows B's public key. So A will take B's public key and encrypt the key itself with B's public key. So now you have this thing done and this uses public key crypto. So what is the advantage of this? One thing that I could have done is I could have taken the message M and I could have encrypted the entire thing using B's public key. So this is one alternative. So this versus this, let us see the advantage of this over this. If I took the message and encrypted it with B's public key, then to decrypt this message, it can be decrypted only by B. B would have to use B's private key. The problem is that this message might be, say, hundreds of kilobytes. And that would take a long time because this uses exclusively public key cryptography. So it'll take a long time. So look at the idea. The idea is instead of using this, use this. Now over here, I've generated this session key, K. I've encrypted the message with that thing. So the message is kilobytes long. And because secret key is much more efficient compared to public key cryptography, it doesn't take me that much time to do this. On the other hand, I also have to use public key cryptography, but I'm only encrypting the key. So what is the key size? So typically the key size would be something like 128 bits if I'm using secret key crypto. So this thing doesn't take me much time. Neither does this because I'm using secret key cryptography over here. So notice what I'm doing. I'm sending this thing together with this thing and I'm using both secret key cryptography and public key cryptography. When the receiver receives this message that contains this part of the message and this part, what should he do? He should take this thing and decrypt it using his private key to get the secret key K and then use the secret key to decrypt this ciphertext. So here I get the advantages of both key management as well as speed. Okay, so with that brief introduction, let us now go to these two terms that are used very commonly and that are the building blocks of elementary ciphers. So the elementary ciphers that we are talking about, the building blocks of most secret key ciphers, substitution boxes and transposition boxes. Let us see what these things mean. So the best examples or the simplest examples are the so-called Caesar cipher and the Wegener and Hill cipher. So for simplicity, we will talk about the Caesar cipher here and defer this to some other time, the Wegener and the Hill cipher. So what is the Caesar cipher? Most of you have already seen this, and it is basically a substitution cipher. So very simple example, replaces each alphabet in plain text by an alphabet k positions away in the modulo 26 sense. So for example, if k is equal to 3, the substitutions are substitute the ciphertext D for A. So this is the plain text A and you substitute for D, substitute E for B and so on and so forth. So what is your name becomes, you take W and you take three alphabets ahead of W, which is Z, H, three alphabets ahead is K and so on and so forth. So this is the ciphertext corresponding to the plain text, what is your name. Now it's very obvious what you do to decrypt it. To decrypt it, you just go three alphabets behind. So what is the key in this case? The key is the number 3. It tells me that to encrypt, I use the alphabet 3 units ahead, and to decrypt, I use the alphabet 3 units behind. A very simple cipher. The reason I brought this up is because this is the simplest example of a substitution cipher. Now, obviously, whenever we talk about some mechanism in security, the next question is, can we attack this? So, is it possible to attack this? Of course, I'm sure you will all see this. By observing large amounts of ciphertext, we may be able to guess the plain text. Now, the reason for that is because I can look at some statistical properties of, say, the English language. Typically have certain properties, for example, in English, the alphabet that is most common, you'd expect the vowels to be most common. So in English, the E is the most common, followed by T, A, O, I, and N. So if I look at the ciphertext and I find a large number of occurrences of the character, say, X, I suspect that the X came from one of these. Then I look and see which is the next most prominent character, say the next most prominent is P. Then again, I suspect that P is one of these, and I put all these facts together, and then I'm able to decrypt it. So the key over here is to use the statistical properties of human language. Deducing plain text from only knowledge of the corresponding ciphertext. So notice that I only looked at the ciphertext to be able to try to decipher it. So deducing plain text from only knowledge of the corresponding ciphertext is referred to as a known ciphertext attack. Okay, so we'll skip these. They're all in the slides which you have. Okay, the other building block is the transposition cipher. So what is this thing? It's basically a rearrangement of characters or bits. So for example, just as a very good way of doing this, imagine that the characters in text are arranged in a matrix. And then you shuffle the rows and the columns of this matrix in a predictable fashion. And a predictable means it's known to the decryption software. Let's take this as plain text. Begin operation at noon. So all these characters can be arranged in a matrix like this. So a 5x4 matrix. And now I want to transpose this thing. So there are different ways in which you can transpose. Basically, you can shuffle the rows followed by shuffling of the columns. Again, you can shuffle the rows and again the columns and so on and so forth. The only thing is that the guy on the other side who receives the shuffled thing should know how you did the shuffling. So the key basically is the order in which you shuffle the rows and the columns. So for example, consider this. The first kind of transposition is I substitute row 1 for row 3. So row 1 now goes to row 3. Then row 2 goes to row 5. So this is row 2, it's gone to row 5. Row 3 is gone to row 2 and so on and so forth. So I rearrange the rows. Let's not stop at that. Let's rearrange the columns. So column 1 goes to column 4. So 1, this column has now gone there. 2 has gone to 3 and so on and so forth. So let's suppose I just did one pass of shuffling of the rows and one pass of shuffling of the columns. Then what I get is I just read out this matrix A, T, N, O, and so on and so forth. So this is the ciphertext for the plain text, which was two slides before. Begin operation at noon, now appears like this. And it's very hard for me to tell that this thing came from begin operation at noon, unless I have the key. But of course, I can be smarter than that and try to figure out certain bits of certain characters in this by using a known ciphertext attack. The statistical properties of the English language. I will just end this particular session with the difference between block ciphers and stream ciphers. So this is a very important differentiation between the two. These are both secret key schemes, but some of them, for example, like stream ciphers, are widely used in wireless communications. Now with block ciphers, the plain text is split into fixed size chunks called blocks, and each block is encrypted separately. Typically, all the blocks in the plain text are encrypted using the same key. So that's the feature. You have a message, say this long a message, and then you split the message into blocks. The question is, how large should that block be? Or is it a variable size kind of thing? So typically, it's a fixed size block. In the case of AES, you can have a block size of 128, or you can have a block size of 192 or 256. You decide on one and then stick with it. So let's say 128. In the case of RSA, the block size is the number of bits used to represent the modulus. For example, 1024 or 2048. So you take the entire message and you split it up, the first block of size 128, the next block 128, next block 128, and you encrypt each of those things separately. That is the basic idea of a block cipher. And a stream cipher, another important kind of cipher, over here what happens is these things, stream ciphers, operate on bits. So practical stream ciphers typically generate a pseudo-random key stream. So a random stream, arbitrary size key stream, which is a function of a fixed length key and a per message bit string. So there are two things that go into creating this arbitrary size bit stream. So I just generate a very large bit stream. That bit stream is a function of two things, a per message bit string and a fixed length key that is known to the sender and the receiver. So the key remains fixed, but this thing keeps varying. So as a function of both these two things, the key stream will be different for each different message. This thing remains fixed from message to message, while this thing varies from message to message. And as a function of both of these things, you generate a key stream. And what do you do once you obtain the key stream? You exclusive OR the key stream with the original plain text. So the ciphertext is obtained by performing an XOR operation between the plain text and the key stream. So a good example of a stream cipher is RC4, which is used in wireless communications, in a wireless LAN, for example. As I mentioned before, the building blocks of a secret key cipher are the S-box and the P-box. What Shannon had shown several decades ago was that you can alternate S-boxes and P-boxes, and you can construct a very powerful cipher as a result of that. Now the question is, what exactly is an S-box and what is a P-box? The S-box is basically a substitution box that substitutes, that performs a substitution function like the ones I'd shown you before. And a P-box is basically a permutation box which performs a transposition. So transposition or permutation by shuffling around the bits inside the plain text. So you use an S-box, then use a P-box, and then you use a box that performs a simple operation involving a round key. So there are multiple rounds and you repeat this thing. So one round is basically something like an S-box function, P-box function, and this exclusive OR of the resulting bit stream and the round key. And then you repeat this, say 10 times in the case of AES or 16 times in the case of DES, and you get a very powerful cipher. So pictorially, a P-box looks like this. Basically, you are just shuffling the bits. This is the original plain text and you're shuffling it. First bit goes over here, the second bit goes there, and so on and so forth. And S-box is a little bit more complicated. You have a encoder and a decoder. So the decoder first over here will take 3 bits and split it up into 8 bits. And then these 8 bits are shuffled around and then they are finally encoded. So this is really an S-box, which is much more complicated than a simple P-box. So here's the cipher. The first stage would be P1 followed by little substitution boxes, and then a P2, the second stage, followed by little substitution boxes, and so on and so forth. So once again, as far as the S-box is concerned, an S-box or substitution box is a device that takes as input a binary string of length M and returns a binary string of length N. Any kind of substitution for these M bits by N bits would be a substitution function. Implemented need not be a permutation, because after all M and N need not be the same. Implemented using a table or array of 2 raised to M rows, with each row returning an N bit value. The input to the S box is used to index the table. So you've got M inputs, and these M inputs function as an index into the table. So there are 2 raised to M entries into the table, and each of those entries is really an N bit entry. So if you take M bits as input, you get as output N bits. So this is a very simple example where M is equal to N is equal to 3. So 3 bit input and 3 bit output, and 000 is substituted for itself, 001 for this, and so on and so forth. So this is a very simple substitution box. A P box performs a permutation or rearrangement of the bits in the input. So if this is, for example, the bits of the plain text, and these are the bits of the ciphertext, then for example, you could implement a simple shift kind of function O0, this thing is equal to I3. So you take this bit and you put it in this position, the least significant bit position, and I3 is equal to O0. O1 is equal to I4 and so on and so forth. So you somehow permute these bits to get the output, and the permutation is specified over here. So this is the example of a permutation or a transposition, where you're just shuffling around the bits. Another term that is used very often is a round key. Each stage of round involves a round key operation. The round key is obtained as a function of the original key. So notice once again that every round has at least three operations. Those three operations are a substitution, a transposition, and a round key operation. So this is the third of these three, the round key operation. And this is a simple example of an SPN network. S stands for substitution, P is permutation, a three-round substitution permutation network. This first round over here, this is a round key operation. Now here you have a substitution box. So there are three substitution boxes. And then you have, so you take the outputs of all of them and then you shuffle them around. So this basically implements a transposition. Then once again, you have a round key operation, substitution, and transposition, and so on and so forth. You can do this 3 times, 4 times, 10 times, etc. So this is the building block. This is a template for a secret key cipher, and the building blocks are these S boxes and these permutation boxes. We will now straight away go to this discussion of different operating modes which you will require in the lab. So when we talk about a secret key cipher, there are different modes in which this can be used. The most basic is an electronic codebook mode. Then there's the CBC mode, the cipher feedback mode, output feedback mode, and the counter mode. So we'll at least look at two or three of these. The most basic and easy to understand is the electronic codebook mode. So the message is split into fixed length consecutive chunks called blocks, and each block is independently encrypted into its corresponding block of ciphertext using the same key. So for a given message, as mentioned before, you take the message and you chunk it up into fixed length chunks called blocks. So there's a block P1, block P2, which could be, for example, 128 bits. So 128 bits here, 128 bits there, and so on until the end of the message. And then you encrypt it using the same key K, this encryption box. This could be, for example, the AES function. And you encrypt it and you get the corresponding blocks of ciphertext C1, C2, etc. So this is the simple electronic codebook mode of operation. Now, as we will see in the lab also, for an example, there are some drawbacks of the ECB mode. Identical blocks of plain text will be encrypted as identical blocks of ciphertext. So this is one problem. Suppose, for example, an eavesdropper notices that blocks 23 and 95 are equal. In addition, if he knows or can guess the value of block 23 of plain text, he can then deduce the content of block 95. So let's see what this means in terms of a picture. Suppose, for example, I find that this block of ciphertext is the same as this block of ciphertext. And let's suppose that I happen to know that this plain text was something. Say an HTTP message, you have GET and so on, which is simple ASCII. So I happen to know the plain text for this, which I will know in the case of things like the HTTP header, which is in simple text. So the HTTP header, for example, some of those characters are in this. So I happen to know this. I can, of course, see this, the ciphertext. And I happen to notice that this block of ciphertext is the same as this block. Then I can conclude that this block of plain text is the same as this block. So likewise, there might be sensitive information in this block over here, which I happen to know. But because this block of ciphertext is the same as this, I can conclude that this block of plain text is the same as this. So this is one of the key drawbacks of the ECB mode. For which purpose, people came up with another mode, which is cipher block chaining. So in pictures, what does this look like? So here are the blocks of plain text. And what you do is, before you pass it through the encryption box, you have an exclusive OR gate. So this is gated with what? In the first block, it's gated with the initialization vector. IV stands for initialization vector. And then you pass it through the encryption function and you get the ciphertext. And then this block of ciphertext, the output over here, which is the same as this, this block of ciphertext is then exclusive OR'd with the next block of plain text to give you the input to the next E box. And again, this thing is encrypted with the same key K to get the next block of ciphertext, and so on and so forth. Now, the advantage of this scheme is that suppose I see that this is the same as this, suppose I see that this is the same as this, and if I know this, then there is no way for me to conclude that this is the same as this, because this thing takes as input, this exclusive OR gate takes as input this as well as this, and this is in all likelihood something that's very random. So some random thing gets input over here, some random thing gets inputted over here, so this becomes random and this becomes random. So even if I know this block of plain text, and if I know that this block of ciphertext is the same as this block of ciphertext, I cannot conclude that this block of plain text is the same as this block. So this is the advantage of CBC mode of operation. As far as decryption is concerned, I just look at it from the reverse side. I get this block of ciphertext, I decrypt it, so I get this value. I know the IV at the receiver side, and I exclusive OR this and this, and I get the first block of plain text. Then to get the next block of plain text, I got this block of ciphertext, I decrypt it, I get this value, I know this value from here, and I exclusive OR this and this to get the next block of ciphertext, and so on. So this is how encryption and decryption is done using the CBC mode. The other mode that I would like to touch upon is the counter mode. So the counter mode, what you do is you initialize the count to some arbitrary value, this has to be random, and then you encrypt it, and then you exclusive OR the output with the plain text to get the ciphertext. So this is a random number, you encrypt that counter value, and then you exclusive OR that value with this plain text to give you the corresponding ciphertext. Then the next one is X plus 1 for the next block of plain text. So this block of plain text, the next block of plain text, you simply take the counter value, incremented by 1, and encrypt it, and then exclusive OR it with the plain text to get the ciphertext, and so on and so forth. So one of the advantages of this mode is you can parallel process. You can do this at the same time as you do this, because there's no feedback between all these stages. So at the same time as you're processing this, you can process this and all of these, for example. Or even, you don't have to wait for this to be completed before you start something else. What if this block has not come, but this block has come? You can still process this block even though this one has not come. So there is no dependency between these, between the processing of all these blocks. So in words, in the counter mode, a B-bit counter is initialized to a random value. This value is encrypted with a secret key and then XORed with the first block of plain text. The counter is then incremented. The incremented value is encrypted and XORed with the next block of plain text to create the next block of ciphertext, and so on. So the advantage, as I mentioned before, you can encrypt block 10 before you encrypt block 1. And also you can perform these operations in parallel. Okay, so now that we've talked about secret key ciphers, how they are constructed, the template for constructing them using a P-box, an S-box, and the round key operation, the next thing is, what is the application of a secret key cipher? So obviously, the first thing is to take a message and encrypt it so that you ensure confidentiality. Now, as I mentioned before, you can do this also using public key cryptography, but the advantage of using secret key cryptography in encryption is that it is much, much faster, about three orders of magnitude better. It is also used to protect the privacy of stored documents by encrypting it. So besides messages, you can also encrypt documents before you store them on disk, for example. Besides confidentiality, the next big thing is authentication. So secret key cryptography is also used for both entity authentication and message authentication. So entity authentication involves making sure, as mentioned before, that the party you are establishing connection with is indeed the party you intend to communicate with. So we will discuss authentication protocols in some detail later. Let us look at entity authentication and message authentication. From the perspective of message authentication, how can we use secret key cryptography? Message authentication involves making sure that each and every message that has been exchanged is indeed from the party that participated in the establishment of that connection or session, and it is handled on a per message basis. So you want to guarantee both authentication and also integrity. And both of these can be provided by using something called a message authentication code, which basically uses, at least one of the ways in which you can implement it is using secret key cryptography. So what is a message authentication code? It's a fixed length one-way function of two things. There are two things that are needed to generate the MAC. So the MAC is a function of the message and also a secret that is shared between the sender and the receiver. So for each message to be sent, the sender computes a MAC which is appended to the message. On receive of the message and the MAC, the recipient computes the same function on the message and the secret shared with the sender and checks for a match with the received MAC. So let's see if we can try to make some sense of this. So one way in which you can do this is through using the CBC mode of the secret key operation. Another way in which you can do this is using the cryptographic hash. So there are some very powerful properties of the MAC. If even a single bit of the message is corrupted, the MAC for the new message should be quite different from the MAC computed on the original message. So this is a very important property. Even if one bit of the MAC is corrupted, if of the message is corrupted, the new MAC will be completely different from the original MAC. Another thing is knowing one or more message MAC pairs, it should be computationally infeasible to deduce the secret. It should be computationally infeasible to generate a MAC for any fresh message without knowledge of the secret. So let us see what are some of these different properties. So here is a message, I want to compute the MAC on this message. So typically what I will do is, I will send the message together with the MAC to the receiver. What is this supposed to guarantee? Two things, integrity and also message authentication. So basically the MAC is a one-way function of two things, of the message and the secret key. Now suppose I have a message M1 and the MAC is MAC1 over here. Now suppose I corrupt this message and I create a message M1 prime with just one bit difference between this and this. Then this value is going to be completely different from this value. There'll be no relationship between these two values. So the attacker cannot try to figure out, suppose I change this thing. So here's what the attacker is saying. He's saying I change this thing, this message contains a salary field, and I change it from 20,000 to 90,000. Then can I change the MAC so the receiver will not know that I've changed the salary? The answer is no, because this MAC bears no resemblance whatsoever to this MAC. So this is a very interesting property of the MAC. So that's the first thing, one important property. The next question is, how do I verify the MAC at the receiver end? So at the receiver end, I've got this value and I've got this value, but I also know this value because this is the secret that both sides share to compute the MAC and to verify the MAC. So at the receiver side, I have got this value and I've got this value, and I also know this value. Only the sender and receiver know this value. So what I do is, I take the message and I know the secret. At the receiver side, this is what I do. I know the secret K, I compute this, and I verify whether this gives me the same thing as this. I have received this, and I know this. If I receive this and I know this, I can compute this. And since I've received this, I compare whether this output is the same thing as this value. And if they are, I conclude that the message has been transmitted without loss of integrity and the message has been created and sent by the authentic user. So these are some of the properties of the MAC. How do I verify the MAC? What happens if I change even a single bit over here? Now the next question is, a hacker might try, for example, to obtain different MAC pairs. So he's observing on the line that MAC2 is equal to F of M2 comma K. He takes 10,000 such pairs. MAC3 is equal to F of M3 comma K. The question is, after all this knowledge of M2, so he knows M2 and the corresponding MAC2. He knows M3 and the corresponding MAC3. The question is, can he find out what is the value of K? And the answer is no, if the MAC is designed properly. So if the MAC is designed properly, even though he might have 10,000 or 10 million of such pairs, he will not be able to figure out the value of K. Now the question is, how did we construct such a great kind of thing, the MAC? So there are two ways in which you can construct the MAC. One is using secret key cryptography in CBC mode. So we just showed you what is CBC mode out there. And the second thing is using the crypto hash. So to construct, so one way to construct the MAC using secret key cryptography is this thing. So now here I have the original message. So I just put the blocks of the message over here. I have an initialization vector that is known to sender and receiver, and I know the key that is also known to sender and receiver. So what do? Is I apply the exclusive OR function and the encryption function on the first block, and I get this value. I keep repeating this thing. I just ignore all these other things because I'm only interested in computing the MAC. So I only consider the last output. So this was the original message split up into blocks, and I do this computation, and then I only consider this last block of ciphertext, and that is my MAC. So this MAC then, as you can obviously see, is a function of this entire message together with the initialization vector and the key K. So what is done at the receiver side? The receiver does exactly this computation and verifies whether what he has computed over here, the MAC, is what has been received by him. So he does exactly the same computation to verify the MAC. He takes the message. I'm not talking about encryption now. I'm not interested in encryption. I'm only interested in integrity protection and authentication. So he takes the original message in plain text. So he sees the original message. He knows this key value because it's shared between sender and receiver, and he knows the IV. So he computes the MAC and he verifies whether what he's computed is the same thing as what he has received. So this is basically the MAC construction, which I just showed in the picture. Imagine encrypting each message block using DES in CBC mode, with the encryption key being the secret shared by sender and receiver. All blocks of the ciphertext except for the last block are discarded. The last block is used as the MAC for that particular message. And of course, this MAC is also a function of not only the message and the key, but also the IV. So the IV is supposed to be known by both sides. Now a little bit of RSA. So public key cryptography, one of the best known schemes is RSA. Another very well known scheme is ECC. And we'll cover ECC towards the end of this workshop. So RSA has been around for quite a while, since 1977, and it originated with Rivest, Shamir and Adelman, one of the most widely used public key algorithms even today. And the security of this scheme is based on the difficulty of factorizing a large number that is itself the product of two very large prime numbers. The operations that we are responsible for are three things: key generation, encryption, and decryption. What is the use of RSA? For confidentiality, encrypt using receiver's public key. So as we have said before, to encrypt something using RSA, use the receiver's public key. Only the receiver can decrypt this, and for that purpose, he needs to use his private key. Again, as mentioned before, RSA operations are much more computationally intensive compared to secret key operations. And a solution is what I described on the paper: use a combination of secret key and private key crypto. So for that purpose, we come up with a session key, we encrypt the session key with the recipient's public key, and then encrypt the entire message with the random secret that we have just chosen as the session key. So this is basically, in words, what I described before. Okay, so before we go to the cryptographic hash, a very brief background of RSA, how that is done, the mathematical operations. So key generation first. I choose two very large primes, P and Q. Each of these is about at least 1024 bits. If you want more security, the next key size would be something like, say, 2048. So I choose two large primes, P and Q. I compute the modulus, which is P times Q. Then I choose encryption key and encryption key E, which is relatively prime to phi of n. So phi of n or phi of n is the number of integers that is relatively prime to n, the number of integers between 1 and n minus 1 that is relatively prime to n. So this number, in the case of n being the product of two primes, turns out to be this. Now I choose an E that is relatively prime to phi of n. So the GCD of E and phi of n is equal to 1. And then I compute D as the inverse of E mod phi of n. So all of this is explained in the book on the chapter on RSA. So ED is 1 mod phi of n. So this is basically key generation. Now encryption, if I've got a message M, then to encrypt it, so this is the ciphertext, the message to the power of E mod of n, and then to decrypt it, hopefully if I do the this operation, I will decrypt it, C raised to D, and only I can decrypt it because I know the decryption key or the private key. So in the lab this afternoon, we are going to use OpenSSL to look at what are the values, possible values of P, Q, N, E, D, and if I take some plain text and I put it in a file, I would like to see the corresponding ciphertext, etc. So this is encryption and this is decryption. So three operations: key generation, encryption, decryption, in a nutshell. The next important element in cryptography is the cryptographic hash, which is used to, for example, obtain digital signatures. So what is the cryptographic hash? Its purpose is to produce a fingerprint or a digest of a block of data. So just like your fingerprint is unique to most individuals, so this cryptographic hash applied on a message will be unique for different messages, more or less. Almost certainly, it will be unique for each message. The block of data can be a message, a document, etc. So I can apply the cryptographic hash on a message, on a document, etc. For a given hash function, the size of the digest is fixed, though the input can be of arbitrary size. So I can take a message of size 1 kilobyte or 100 megabytes, but the digest size will always be something small number, like say 128 bits in the case of MD5 or 160 bits in the case of SHA-1. There are some extremely important properties upon which the security of signature schemes rests, and also of the MAC rests. So one such property is the one-way property. So basically the cryptographic hash is a function. So given an X, it is easy to compute H of X, the hash of X. But given a Y, it is computationally infeasible to find an X such that Y is equal to H of X. So it's impossible almost to invert something. So let's see, we have a slide that shows this. The one-way property. It's very easy for me to go from here to here. Given any value, x, it's very easy for me to compute h of x. But if I'm given a value over here, it's virtually impossible for me to find any one value in this set that maps to this value. So it's not really invertible. That's why it's called the one-way function. It's easy to go from year to year, but almost impossible to go in the reverse direction. There are, for example, so these are the, this is a set of messages which is infinite. So as I said before, messages can be of arbitrary size. So these are just basically bit strings and they can be of any length. But all of these things are of length, for example, 128 bits. So there are only 2 raised to 128 things on this side and an infinite number of things on this side. So something tells you that there are many things over here on this side that map to the same thing on this side. Nevertheless, if I give you anything on this side, it's virtually impossible for the attacker to say where it came from. So that's why it's got this one-way property. It's an inherent property of the cryptographic hash. Besides this property, there are also properties of collision resistance. The first is weak collision resistance. Given an X, it's computationally infeasible to find a Z such that h of x is equal to h of z. So you're given an x and you have to find a z such that h of x is equal to h of z. And the third property of strong collision resistance, it is computationally infeasible to find any two. So I give you the liberty, I don't say I'm giving you the x, you find the y. I'm saying you yourself choose any two things you want which have the same hash value. And even that is almost impossible. So illustrating weak collision resistance, for example, if you have one value that's given to you, x1 or x, can you find a y such that they both map to the same value? Now, there are an infinite number of these guys that map to this, and yet it's virtually impossible for you to find even one of those guys. So I'm giving you this, I'm asking you, can you find one of these guys, both of whom map to the same value in this set? So this is the property of weak collision resistance. And strong collision resistance is, I don't say this, I don't come and say, I specify, I'm giving you this. I just say, just find any two things in this set. I'm happy if you find any two things in this set that both map to the same value. And even that problem of strong collision resistance is impossible. So these are the properties of the cryptographic hash. And the book has a discussion of how you can actually generate a cryptographic hash, an example of the MD5, for example. So what are the uses of the cryptographic hash? So here are some of them: to create a digest of a message for integrity purposes, to create a MAC. So before, we showed an example of generating a MAC using the secret key cryptography in CBC mode, but you can equally well use a MAC, use a cryptographic hash to create a MAC. And then another important property is to create a digital signature. So how do we create a MAC using the cryptographic hash? Very simple. You just take the message, you concatenate it with the secret key and take the hash of that, and that is the MAC. This is why the MAC is also referred to as a keyed hash. A keyed hash, because you are actually using the key over here and concatenating it with the message, then taking hash function to obtain the MAC. So you convince yourselves that if I know this value, the MAC value, if I know the message, and if I have many such pairs that I know, M1 and MAC1, M2 and MAC2, etc., you will not be able to still find the value of K. If you see something like this, the MAC value and the corresponding message, and if I want to tamper with this message, there is no way for me to compute the new MAC on the tampered message. Even if I change the message by one bit, it's impossible for me to compute the new MAC. So it is these very strong cryptographic properties that make it so very useful. Useful in what? In message integrity and message authentication, for example. But it's also got other uses. The next important use is in signatures. So verifying the MAC, I think you can all figure that out. On receipt of the message and the MAC, the receiver derives the MAC using the common secret and the received message. How does he do that? The MAC is equal to the hash function of the message concatenated with the common secret. So he computes this, and then he verifies whether this is the same thing that he obtained from the sender. A change of even a single bit in the message of the MAC will result in a mismatch between the computed MAC and the received MAC. And then he will know if the computed MAC does not match the received MAC, he will know that the message has been tampered with on the way. So that's a summary of what the MAC provides, a combination of integrity and message authentication. Now, all of these things you will be seeing in the lab today using OpenSSL. There are certain command line statements that you can use to generate the MAC on a message, to generate, to encrypt, to decrypt, to generate keys, and all sorts of things. And then finally, the signature. So the normal human signature, the manual signature, has certain properties, or you would like it to have certain properties. It should be authentic. So when I see a signature, I know that it is Rajesh's signature. So this is Rajesh's signature. I look at the signature. If I know Rajesh's signature, I've seen it many times, I will see a new signature and I'll say, okay, it is his. That's what happens at the bank. In a machine, you go, say a teller machine, he will look at the check and he'll look at the signature. Or if you're trying to withdraw money from the bank, you will just fill up a form and you'll sign. And then the guy at the counter will verify the signature with the signature in the database. And he'll say, yes, this is the authentic signature of Rajesh. So the signature should be authentic. That means it is indeed Rajesh's signature. Now, this is different from this. It should not be forgeable. Just because it looks like Rajesh's signature doesn't mean that Rajesh actually signed it. It could be some guy who's very good at forging people's signatures. So he can sign just like Rajesh. Still, you want to detect that. So it's not enough for me to just say that this is Rajesh's signature. I also need to say that it has actually been signed by Rajesh. Now, it's not very easy for me to do that in the real world with manual signatures, but with digital signatures, it is indeed possible. it should not be possible to repudiate a signature. So Rajesh signs this check that he gives me, and then 10 days later he says, no, it was not I who signed this check. It should not be reusable. If I'm a bad guy, Rajesh gives me a check for 10,000 rupees, and then I steal his checkbook, I write another check, and I reuse that same signature on this other check. So he's given me a check for 10,000, now I write another check with his name, and somehow I reuse that signature, I pluck it out from the original check, and I make another check from Rajesh to me of 1 lakh. It should not be reusable. And it should not be possible to alter a signed document. So I sign this check, 10,000 rupees, and then very nicely I make it 20,000. So Rajesh has given me a check to be credited to my account, 10,000 rupees check, and I very nicely change that 10 to 20. And the bank accepts this, even though it's a fraud. Now all of this thing needs to be checked if we are going to use digital signatures. Of course, with manual signatures, they can also check it, but how do we check it with digital signatures? So the first thing is, what is an RSA signature? What is a digital signature? There are many kinds of digital signatures. RSA is just one. There's another one called DSA. There's another one called ECDSA, which stands for elliptic curve DSA, and so on and so forth. So the signature really looks very nice and elegant. You take the message, you perform the cryptographic hash on the message. So this message is a huge message, let's say 20 kilobytes. You take the message and you perform the cryptographic hash. So this entire thing reduces to the size of a fingerprint of that message, which is about 128 bits. And then you go ahead and encrypt it with the signer's private key. A is signing it, she will encrypt it with her private key. So a sender's digital signature guarantees not just integrity and authentication, but also non-repudiation. Nobody else has your private key. So you cannot go to the court and say it was signed by somebody else. Unless, of course, your key was compromised. And it's your responsibility to keep your private key safely. So if I can verify your signature, it is your responsibility. You have signed it for all practical purposes. So a sender's digital signature guarantees not just integrity and authentication, but also the property of non-repudiation. That is, the signer of a document cannot later deny having signed it, since she alone has knowledge or access to a signing key. So if I have a message, and if I find this quantity, so a message and this quantity, I have to conclude that it must have been signed using this person's private key, and must have been signed by this person unless she has compromised her private key. And if she has compromised her private key, it is her responsibility to go and complain to the certification authority that indeed it was lost, and to disregard all signatures that will be signed henceforth. So that's the role of the PKI, the public key infrastructure, which we'll talk about it tomorrow. And then some common cryptographic hashes, the MD5, the SHA-1. If you want more security, there's SHA-256 with those many bits, and so on. So the next part of this session is going to be a presentation which closely mirrors what you'll be doing in the lab. So we will try to answer all doubts. We'll anticipate doubts and try to answer them. So please tune in and pay attention very carefully as the demo is in progress.